Let's talk about energy balance in closed systems. If we have a closed system like this, we can say that the energy in minus the energy out gives us the change in the energy of the system. Energy in and out can happen due to heat, work, or mass transfers. The change in energy can be internal energy, kinetic energy, potential energy, and more. You might recall that this is pretty much the first law of thermodynamics. Today, we're going to dig a bit deeper and focus on internal energy change. Let's do a quick recap. When energy transfers in and out in rate form, for example, in watts, in other words, joules per second, we can write our energy balance equation like this. A dot on top means it's with respect to time rate. Now, since we will mostly focus on internal energy change, we need to remember how to find it. To find internal energy, we can use this equation. This is mass, this is the initial internal energy, and this is the final internal energy. When a process takes place, for example, heat is added to a system or work output, there is a change in internal energy. The goal is to figure out this change using the energy balance equation. If we have a situation where heat is transferred for a certain amount of time, for example, a heater being turned on for 10 minutes, or power supplied for 30 minutes, etc., then we can use quantities for a time interval. So we have heat transfer, work transfer, and change in the total energy of the system for a certain time interval. Sometimes, we can have unknown heat and work interactions. In the cases where we don't know a direction for heat transfer or work transfer, we have to assume a direction. The normal convention is to assume heat is going to be transferred into the system, so heat input, and work is done by the system, so work output. We can write it like this. We can break it down further. So net heat is heat in minus heat out, and net work is work output minus work input. If you get a negative answer, that means it's actually opposite to your assumption. Sometimes, we might have to show a change in pressure and specific volume with respect to saturation lines on a graph. When it comes to pure substances, the general pressure versus specific volume graph looks like this. This is the critical point. The left side is the compressed liquid region, the middle being the saturated liquid vapor region, and this area being the superheated vapor region. So if a question asks you to draw a change of pressure and specific volume, you first need to draw a rough version of this graph, and then plot out the pressure points afterwards. Don't worry, we will cover this in the first example. This is what a general temperature versus specific volume diagram looks like. Lastly, you should remember things like quality, how to use property tables, and more. To quickly recap, quality is the ratio of the mass of the vapor to the total mass of the mixture. The equations related to it are these. This topic is covered in detail in the pure substances and property tables video. So if you need a refresh, I highly encourage you to take a look. Now let's go through some examples to see how we can apply what we talked about. In this question, we have a tank that contains refrigerant 134A. Heat is then added and we need to figure out the mass of the refrigerant in the tank and the amount of heat transferred. We also need to draw a pressure versus specific volume diagram. So first, let's write down what we know. The tank has a volume of 0.5 cubic meters. The initial pressure is 160 kilopascals, the quality is 40%, and after heat is transferred, the pressure increases. So final pressure is 700 kilopascals. We can also look at a pressure table for R134A to get the specific volume and internal energy values at 160 kilopascals. So here are the values we need. The saturated liquid and vapor specific volume, the saturated liquid internal energy, and the evaporation internal energy. First, we need to figure out the mass of the refrigerant. Mass is volume divided by specific volume. We're given the volume, but we don't have the specific volume, so let's figure it out. To do so, I'm going to use the saturated liquid and vapor specific volume values in this equation. Let's plug in our values. Remember that this part is the difference between saturated vapor and liquid specific volume. Solving gives us the specific volume. So now, we can go back to our mass equation and plug in our values. Solving gives us the mass of the refrigerant. Next, we need to figure out the amount of heat transferred. This is a closed system because mass doesn't enter or leave. The energy in minus the energy out gives us the change in the energy of the system. The change here is internal energy, which is caused by the addition of heat. There is no potential or kinetic energy change. We can find the change in internal energy using this equation. That means we need to figure out U1 and U2. We can figure out U1 by using this equation, which is pretty similar to the equation we used to figure out the specific volume, but now we're looking at the internal energy. Let's plug in the values we have. Solving gives us the initial internal energy. Finding U2 is a bit more tedious. First, we need to keep in mind that the specific volume we found at the initial stage is the same for the final stage. It's based on mass and volume, and none of those changed. So if we try to use the pressure table, we see that at a pressure of 700 kilopascals, the specific volume for the vapor is 0.029. But notice that the specific volume we found is much higher than that. That means the refrigerant is now a superheated vapor. So we need to look at the superheated vapor table. Now looking at the section for 700 kilopascals, the closest value we have for the specific volume is right here. So I'm going to extrapolate using a basic ratio. We get approximately 377 kilojoules per kilogram. Now we can plug in our values and solve for the heat transfer. The last step is to draw a pressure versus specific volume diagram. First, we draw the general PV saturation line for a pure substance. Now our initial point is right here. The pressure is 160 kilopascals and starts in the saturated liquid vapor region. The next point would be right here, with a pressure of 700 kilopascals. Let's take a look at this problem, where we have a mixture of water and vapor in a container at 100 degrees Celsius. Let's write down what we know. The volume is 10 liters, or 0.01 cubic meters. The initial temperature is 100 degrees Celsius, and the final temperature is 150 degrees Celsius. The quality is 12.3%. We will also need to look at the temperature table to find the specific volume values and internal energy values. So here are the values we need. Now the energy in minus the energy out is equal to the change in the energy of the system. We have heat that's transferred to the system, which creates a change in the internal energy of the system. There is no potential or kinetic energy change. So looking at our equation, we don't have any of the values we need. So let's figure them out. First, we will find the mass. Mass is volume divided by specific volume. We're given the volume, but not the specific volume. To figure out the specific volume, we can use this equation. Let's plug in our values. Again, remember that this is the vapor specific volume minus the liquid specific volume. Let's solve. Now we can plug this value into our mass equation to figure out the mass. The next step is to find the initial and final internal energies. We can find U1 using this equation. Let's plug in our values. That gives us the initial internal energy. To find the final internal energy, we need to think about the final state. In other words, when the temperature is 150 degrees Celsius. Keep in mind that the specific volume is still the same, since it's related to mass and volume, and none of those changed, but everything else is different now. So we need to find the internal energies and the saturated specific volumes for both liquid and vapor states when the temperature is 150 degrees Celsius. Here are the values we need. Remember that quality is a ratio between the mass of the vapor to the total mass of the mixture. When the temperature increases, this value could have changed, so we need to figure out the new value. To do so, we will use this equation. Let's plug in our values. Solving gives us the new quality. To find the final internal energy, we can use the same equation we used to find the initial internal energy. Let's solve to get our final internal energy. We can finally go back to the first equation we had and plug our values in. Solving gives us the amount of energy that was transferred into the system. Let's take a look at this question, where we have a container filled with motor oil. There is a stirring device inside this container, and it's supplied 1.5 watts of power, and heat is also supplied. We need to figure out the specific energy increase. Let's write down what we know. The container has 2.5 kilograms of oil. The heat is transferred at a rate of 1 watt, which is 1 joule per second, and 1.5 watts of power is applied to the stirring device, which is 1.5 joules per second, so that's shaft power. The energy in minus the energy out is equal to the change in energy of the system. Now we have two energy inputs, the heat and the shaft power. There is no energy loss, and that's equal to the change in the energy of the system. Let's plug in our values. Since the question wants us to find the specific energy increase, we just need to divide this by the mass, and that's our answer. That should cover the types of problems you will face when it comes to energy balance. In the next video, we will go over specific heats and how that affects some of the energy balance questions. Thanks for watching and best of luck with your studies.